The Philippine Senate set to launch an investigation into the alleged signature buying in the push for charter change believed to be initiated by House lawmakers. This even after the poll body suspended proceedings for a people's initiative. Sherry Antores reports.
Senators and Senate employees went to work on Monday wearing maroon armbands with a strong message.
Nag-isas tayo sa Senado laban sa People's Initiative. Ang layunin ay tanggalin ng Senado at mawawala yung check and balance ng ating sistema. Hindi maganda yan para sa atin.
Progressive group Bayan Muna has already started getting the signatures of those who want to withdraw their PI form signatures, which the group intends to submit to the Commission on Elections. But on Monday, the COMELEC ordered the indefinite suspension of the People's Initiative process. During Monday's session, senators applauded the COMELEC for issuing the PI directive as they issued an appeal to the House of Representatives.
We remind the House of Representatives that the Constitution is not there to expand our powers as elected officials. Quite the opposite. It serves as a limit on the exercise of these powers.
Kung magmamatigasan yan, at i-insist nila that, ay, teka muna, nauna ako eh, dapat maunahan kita. Parang, ano yun eh, parang unahan. At saka, mas malakas yung kapit ko. Ikaw, hindi ka masyadong malakas. No? Paano gagalaw yung center of power?
According to Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri, he met the President Sunday along with Executive Secretary Lucas Bersabin and Presidential Chief Legal Counsel Juan Ponce Enrile. Zubiri says the President has also promised to discuss his PI concerns with a congressman.
As such, the President is set to appeal to the House of Representatives and the other People's Initiative's initiators to stop this dreaded PI, or their version of the People's Initiative. In his words, Madam President, my dear colleagues, it is getting out of hand.
Senators also thanked the 44 districts that did not submit signatures to the COMELEC. The Senate's investigation on the alleged PI payoffs will commence on Tuesday. The Senate President says they will discuss if they will still pursue economic amendments being pushed in resolution of both houses number 6. A House leader meanwhile says they will abandon the People's Initiative if RBH 6 discussion will proceed.
They approve this before the Holy Week and we plan to stop the People's Initiative. To allay fears, ang gusto lang naman namin dito is to be able to have these economic amendments.
Congressmen assured the public they are not out to abolish the Senate. Zubiri, meanwhile, says the Senate will still question the COMELEC's so-called ministerial duty in accepting signed PI forms. The People's Initiative for Reform and Modernization Action, or PIRMA, declined to give a statement. Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
House Majority Leader Manuel Dalipe turning down the Senate's invitation to attend Tuesday's probe. He says House leaders have their hands full crafting legislation for the Filipino people. Dalipe insists House lawmakers are only after amending the economic provisions of the Constitution.
Kasi you cannot do something na hindi parte dun eh. We filed it eh. I think they have to read first what we have filed, instead of trying to speculate or trying to, you know, think of something that is not there. We do not know if this is just a strategy to stonewall again a very important need to update a constitution.
The President's sister, Senator Aimee Marcos, extended an open invitation to House members as the Senate looks into the alleged signature buying scheme for the People's Initiative. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. fires back at his predecessor's fiery speech in Davao. He's blaming former President Rodrigo Duterte's supposed use of fentanyl for his behavior. See, during a prayer rally in his hometown, Duterte accused Marcos of being a drug addict. He also said Marcos was part of a drug watch list of the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency, a claim which the agency quickly denied.
Well, I think this is fentanyl. Fentanyl is the strongest painkiller that you can buy. It is highly addictive, and it has a very serious side effects. And PRRD has been taking the drug for a very long time now. When was the last time he told us that he was taking fentanyl? Well, 5-6 years ago, something like that. After 5-6 years, it has to affect him. Kaya, alam ko, kaya nagkakaganyan. So, you know, I hope his doctors take better care of him than this. Hindi sila pinapabayaan itong mga nagiging problema.
In 2016, Duterte admitted he used to take fentanyl for pain relief after a motorcycle accident. The Philippine House of Representatives maintains its unequivocal support for President Marcos amid this growing rift with the Dutertes. House lawmakers adopted a resolution Monday showing the chamber's firm commitment to the Marcos administration. Newly appointed House Deputy Speaker David Suarez hits Duterte's tirades against Marcos, which he called disrespectful and baseless.
I think it's totally uncalled for. In the past 2 years, we have seen the performance of President Bongbong Marcos. We have seen how he steered reforms in the agriculture sector, in the infrastructure sector, in our economy, in the delivery of social services, and we have seen his commitment to the Filipino people.
President Marcos kicked off his two-day state visit to Vietnam Monday with a meeting with the Filipino community there. In his speech, Marcos lauded the contributions of the migrant workers in the recovery of the Philippine economy after the pandemic.
Kaya't ako'y lubos na nagpapasalamat sa inyong lahat dahil napapadali ang aking trabaho dahil sa magandang reputasyon na itinaguyod nyo sa pamamagitan ng inyong sipag at tiyaga dito sa Vietnam. Bilang pasasalamat, ako at ang ating kasamahan dito sa kabinete ay magpupursiging iahon ang ating bayan mula sa kahirapan na naranasan natin sa panahon ng pandemya. Masasabi ko sa inyo na lumalakas na ang ating ekonomiya ngayon.
Marcos is set to meet with business leaders and sign dozens of deals in various sectors, including agriculture. He will also meet with Vietnamese officials to discuss possible areas of collaboration in maritime security and defense. Vietnam and the Philippines have overlapping claims in the South China Sea, but have friendlier relations compared to Beijing and Manila.
Dahil alam nyo naman ay kailangan natin makipag-ugnayan sa ating kapitbahay na Vietnam para naman maging mapayapa ang South China Sea. Alam natin maraming nangyayari diyan at mas mainam na meron tayong usapan para hindi naman magkagulo, para maiwasan natin ang misunderstanding, magkamali, may madisgrasya, madaling lumakian.
CNN Philippines is shutting down operations on Wednesday due to its massive financial losses. An analyst considered this a huge blow to the country's media landscape. Jackie Pascual reports.
Employees of CNN Philippines gathered for a general assembly for the last time. Nine Media Corporation, operator of CNN Philippines, announced the closure of the media company effective Wednesday, January 31, 2024. The last airing of its live program was Monday, January 29. Nearly 300 employees are affected. Some already packed their belongings, while others took photos of their newsroom for the last time.
It is sad. It's very emotional for me and for my other colleagues. We've had a great 9 years of CNN Philippines.
The company said the closure was due to financial losses. Based on data from the Securities and Exchange Commission obtained by the ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group, CNN Philippines' losses amounted to 239.7 million pesos in 2022, following a loss of 231.4 million in 2021. It also has a capital deficiency of 465.2 million pesos in 2022. Though revenues grew, so did operating costs. Branding or license fee to CNN alone amounted to 139.3 million pesos in 2022. The Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility is saddened by the closure of a major news group in the country. CMFR adds the country needs to have more journalists and reliable news sources amid the influx of disinformation.
My reaction is one of terrible dismay because it lessens the news space that we need. Losing CNN is just a little bit more darkness, I think, in terms of how we're going to proceed. Where is journalism going to go if we are going to be so small a part of the public exchange?
De Jesus also laments the mass layoffs of journalists around the world and the uncertain future of the industry. She urges journalists to come together to discuss what can be done to make the profession more relevant to the public.
I think journalists are just going to have an even more difficult time. But this has been shown all over the world, even in the most vigorous media environments like the U.S. They have lost and they have had closures of their different kinds of news platforms, news content providers, and so many have lost their jobs.
Some of the nearly 300 employees of CNN Philippines have begun looking for new jobs as they hope to get back on their feet as soon as possible. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
ANC, the ABS-CBN News channel, will continue its operations after Sky Cable ends its operations on February 26, as recently announced. ANC programs will continue to be seen on air through our partner cable TV providers nationwide and online via the ANC 24/7 YouTube channel, the ABS-CBN News website, news.abs-cbn.com, and on social media. It will also be on I Want TFC and the Filipino channel. Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Good morning, Lori.
Good morning, ma'am, and to all our viewers and listeners. Right now, we're expecting cloudy skies with rains and thunderstorms over Caraga, Davao region, Camiguin, Misamis Oriental, Bukidnon, and Southern Leyte due to the effect of the trough of the low-pressure area, which is outside the Philippine area of responsibility. Meanwhile, cloudy skies with light rains will still be experienced over Cagayan Valley, Aurora, Quezon, Digol region, and the rest of eastern Visayas due to Amihan. And Amihan will also cause isolated light rains any time of the day over Metro Manila, the rest of Luzon, and the rest of Visayas. For the rest of Mindanao, they will experience localized thunderstorms any time of the day. Then gale warnings still raised over the eastern seaboards of southern Luzon and Visayas and the eastern seaboard of Mindanao. So sea travel is still risky for small sea crafts over the mentioned areas because we will be experiencing or we are expecting rough to very rough seas over the eastern seaboards of southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. That's the latest from PAGASA. This is Lori De La Cruz.
Thank you very much for that update, Lori.